Confessions number 23, the elusive 23. Welcome to the Bastards Council. We got Primate, we got Vin, or Zin, and we have Jay to the oh no, and Ivy. And we've got something planned for you. Why are you looking at me like that?
Now, why the fuck is 23 elusive?
It is.
It is.
How?
We made no, number 23.
You're implying it's non-elusive.
Yeah, I just think it's a regular number. It's just a regular guy.
Why is it a regular number?
He's a guy named Jeffrey. He's got a wife with varicose veins.
The Illuminati and various other secret societies refer to the number 23 as some mystical number of sorts. Anyways, I'm not going to get into that.
Michael Jordan.
But
dude.
Michael Jordan, he's one.
He's not elusive. You can find him.
Oh my God.
Who was number 32? Magic Johnson. And why 32? Well, it's 23 backwards.
And 2 plus 3 is 5.
How old are you? How old are you?
Seriously. 27.
27. Mm. Look at this. Okay?
Yeah, 2 plus 3 is 5. Then take that 2 again. It becomes 7.
Right.
You know, and then replace that 3 with that 7 you just made. And
dude,
the 20
everything
stays 27.
Everything leads back to 23.
You're 36.
From the 23.
You're 36. Find 23.
Divide it in half. Add 10.
At look, 10, because we're 4, we all equal 2.5. So if we all put them together,
yeah,
it's
it
10.
Is.
So, yeah. 13 plus 10.
No, it's not. No.
He stuck to his guns. I don't know.
He believed it for a second, though. No, I was just like, no.
No,
no,
you add 10 and you divide it by 2 is what I meant.
No, you didn't.
No, but that's what I meant.
What's your age?
36.
36. Mm. So I'm 38. So right now, that makes 54. 54 plus 27.
54 and 27.
It's going so far away from 23.
Yeah, but then when you divide it
at some point.
When you divide our ages. Anyways, fuck this.
Fuck this.
Minus the amount of people equals 23.
It's 23. Totally
I'm telling you, it's yeah.
It always goes back to it.
You don't get it. Dude.
It seems like you're finding it a lot. That's not elusive. That's pretty out there.
It's elusive because it's like.
No, it means you can't find it.
It goes. It's
it eludes you.
It eludes you, dude.
No, no, no.
It doesn't elude us because we see it.
This Mandela effect, motherfucker.
This has nothing to do with the Mandela effect.
That's what you think.
That's what
I'm
I think.
Sure, you can find a 23 in there.
Look, it's like you. We saw Armin tag a person today, and
no
he
idea.
Says he didn't do it. Yeah. And he checks; he still doesn't remember doing it.
To benefit, this guy can't remember what he did 5
yeah,
seconds
but it was
ago.
Done at two. No, it was done at 2:23 p.m. Guys. Yeah.
That's why. Didn't you say it was 5?
Holy shit, you see?
Yeah, but it would have been better if it was 23:23 p.m.
No, it's not. Now you're
but
just
that's
being
that
makes sense. Because it's 11:23.
I don't tag people at that time.
Yeah, yes, no, we don't.
Everybody knows I'm an afternoon
tagger.
You
said you don't tag people at all, and you did. All
right, so. Okay, so.
So. What are you stopping for? Continue.
So, Armin had a topic.
He had a topic.
That he wanted to bring to the table.
I'm bringing to the table.
To the council.
How do you open this up?
Open
this candle. I was having a conversation with my uncle. Smart guy. Runs in the family. And it skipped my generation, though. my dad was pretty smart, too. Grandfather.
Your brother.
Anyway, so we're shooting shit, and somehow we got into idolizing people, you know? And it's normal, right? Like, I mean, I think, like, you know, people like James Hetfield or, I don't know, Ozzy. And I'm into the music side. Like,
yeah.
For me, like, I do idolize some people. I still am like that, right? And then I may cross some people that feel the exact same way I feel, which I'll admit is kind of fucking silly. You know, like sometimes I'm like, what the fuck? You're almost 40, dude. What do you give a shit about these guys? But I do. You know, it's fun. That part's fun to me. But when I see somebody have that connection for, as an example, I don't know, like take some really, really big Trekkie, like a Star Trek fan, and like looks up to Captain Kirk, right? And like that guy changed my life, you know? And I'm looking at him, I was like, you do realize that guy doesn't exist. He's not real. You know, then I'll say, yeah, but you know, what makes it different when you like idolize that, like Hetfield, let's say. I was like, well, yeah, that Hetfield guy, he's the actual guy that did the things that made me like him. Write the songs and so on. So be on stage, you know? Maybe he's different when he's off stage, but he's still James Hetfield when he's off fucking stage.
Right.
He's the guy, you know? And, or like, fuck Hetfield. Now go like how I find like somebody worshiping a sport athlete. No, worshiping is a strong word, but you know what I mean.
Idolize.
You know, like take idolizing Gretzky, let's say, or Michael Jordan, 23, you know? And You take that. And to me, that makes sense because, you know, that guy that you're doing, he did this. Now to go a character that somebody else created and you're idolizing that thing is total, like it's kind of, I guess I'm trying to draw a line between fiction and reality over here. You know, I think a fictional hero, in my opinion, should only be looked at so far. You know, look at how some of these people treat the Star Wars cast. You know, Harrison Ford has gone fucking mad because of this. He wants nothing to do with Star Wars, and he's like, "I'm Harrison fucking Ford." You know what I mean? Like,
I'm not Han Solo.
Yeah, Han Solo is just somebody on screen. But I guess they bring them to life, right? And they do have like they're doing something amazing that should be inspiring, but life changing. I don't know about that. Like,
I think it has a lot to do with the personality of the person on screen. And I'm gonna say this. The portrayal of a character means a lot more than just someone writing it, because like you can have a terrible actor and you know
he's still not real.
I know it doesn't matter about not being real. There's a personality that you would look up to. Why do you like James Hetfield aside from the songs? Because you do give a shit about something other than what he's doing musically.
No, take anybody. It's music. I do appreciate that he hasn't gotten fat. And still looks badass on stage, you know.
No,
what
man,
I mean?
You used
but
to scour through fucking interviews, and you did everything you could. Why does it matter if he's writing just music? You get to listen to the music.
He might hint something about. Yeah, no, it starts from the music.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
it's everything
it
else
scours out, right?
It,
so it starts from a show, and I think I obviously
I understand there's a superficial aspect that I'm addicted
yeah,
to
yeah,
also
yeah,
in
course.
This.
I think,
right?
I think,
but at the core of everything. There's a real thing that I'm into.
And that core, you know? Okay, but regardless if it's real or not, if it... Okay, so I think there's an extreme, and I think it's just stupid.
My opinion is it's a little bit weird when I see somebody get into tears when he's talking to William Shatner about Captain Kirk.
Okay, I can give you an example of mine, all right? So Californication started playing when I was around 17. I watched that show religiously. Hank Moody... Definitely, and I can say this 100%. He is a fictional character. He is written on as a TV show, but that character did definitely change my life. And how? And you're wondering how? Because the character on the show was based off of real personalities, and my game with girls shot up after watching.
No problem.
Show.
And
but
you
that,
can draw inspiration
did,
from anything.
But no, it was totally it because was, of that.
But you just said
it's
that
fiction.
It's
written.
Of- Oh, a real personality,
which
it was kind
several.
Of based off of David Duchovny.
Well, not at all, because sort the guy of. Is not, he was a sex addict. Without diverting too much, everyone says it is, but it really isn't. Because
well, I don't know.
He doesn't act at all like
say,
that.
But I just know.
I know.
About
they fans say that. However, regardless of it, it was
like,
mixed personalities.
It makes more sense to me when somebody gets like. Kiss tattooed on his arm, or maybe wrong example, because somebody say that they're a show, but they're not. Like, let's say, or I don't know, someone has a Led Zeppelin tattoo, okay? Then if somebody has a David the fucking Duchovny from Californication on his arm, you know? And I think even you, as much as you love that guy, you also have that line between what's fictional and what's reality.
Sure, but I got fiction.
And I know which side of that
well,
fence
I got fiction
you're
tattooed
on. I know which side of that
though.
Fence everybody's
well,
on,
what's
actually.
The difference? I don't know. I don't really agree because when you think of James Hetfield, you just think of one segment, which is him on stage music. But at the end of the day, is that a character as well?
No. To me, I just said it started from... I didn't know what he fucking looked like when I started. But when I say Hetfield, I'm saying Metallica. Like that, it's because my favorite band. That's why I went
yeah,
there.
I totally get it. Yeah.
But it could be anything. I mean, there's a lot of... Like Gretzky is a big one. I totally
yeah,
think
what,
that guy's gone,
it's
right?
Only- one little segment of his life, but that at the end of the day,
it's not, yeah, it's not the entire thing.
It could be perceived as a character as well, because I think it's hard to idolize anybody else than people you know.
No,
like
it's an achievement. I'm not seeing
like
a character. I see
fucking,
achievement.
You
know
you
what I mean?
Hockey player, Star Wars character, video game character, TV show. I mean, we idolize them for a vision or for something either they do for real or they were made to be, right? So I think... The fact that Vin likes a guy on TV, idolize a part of it, I think that's cool.
Yeah, definitely,
like
but I'm telling you, not as much
cool
as he will for the real stuff.
No, totally
but
not.
What's the difference? Because James Hetfield, I think he had drugs probably, he had other type of problems, so do you idolize a part of it?
No,
that,
no.
Or do you idolize everything?
The music. Again,
but that's
comes
what I'm
down
saying.
To the music.
But music
for,
is just...
No, all I'm saying is, the way I see it, like now, what I'm into is something that Hetfield created, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And Lars and Kirk and Cliff.
Right.
You know? And I give them the credit for it. And they're the same people that I love the product that they made. Now, when it comes to this fictional side, there's Like, you can give credit to the person who acted it out. It's amazing. But some, you know what I mean?
Before you go on, I want to touch on that because someone wrote that part. Someone had to act that part out.
Yeah.
Someone wrote that song. Someone had to play that song.
Well, these guys did it all.
And the guy who acted it for real.
Yes, but he didn't create it. And then the other thing is this.
Regardless of creation.
The person, like, the character doesn't exist. That's that's my only argument is, how could you take it so far if you know the person doesn't exist? It's as crazy as religion.
Here's something I know about actors, because I watched a lot of, like, DVD extras and whatnot. I'll use Seinfeld, since we were actually talking about Seinfeld earlier. So I remember the characters, and you could see this yourself when you watched the show. It's more
fucking good example.
It's more than just the writers, because the actors, when you watch, especially like the first episode of Seinfeld, Kramer especially stands out as not the Kramer that we got to know. In fact, the Kramer that's on that first episode, he comes in, walks in there with a robe. He's naked under that robe. And the character that he is, he's weird, which, yeah, Kramer is normally weird, but he was a different kind of weird. And even George didn't even know, or the guy that plays George, what's his name? Jason Alexander didn't even know how to play George until the third season. And you see there's a transition of him learning how to do it. And then he's the one that came up with all the yelling, the screaming, and just totally losing it like that all the time.
So
actors end up adding a lot of their own creation into it also.
Yeah.
Now, take politics for it. Forget music. Forget those kind of people, right? Now there's public figures and with politics involved or religion involved that are superhuman. People fucking love these guys, right? Now, how many times has a politician been portrayed in a movie? Zillion billion fucking times. All those times they've done great jobs. There's been some presidents that I've seen portrayed on TV that I'm like, if only, right? Mm. Have that shit ever, does anybody worship those fucking fake presidents? No, because they know they're fucking fictional presidents, man.
Well, no, wait, you don't know that.
No, I know it for a fact. Nobody sits there and says that Independence Day, president was such a good president. I'm gonna put his picture on my
Donald phone. Trump did it, but you know.
No, stay fucking serious right
now. No,
right?
Donald Trump actually said that. He's who's the guy who plays the president in Independence Day? Regardless, that actor, Trump actually said, you know, I'm really glad at the way he stood up for America.
But you know what? I think movies is not as good of an example. Well, that's not true.
That's my whole thing over here. It's people on screen, characters on screen.
A TV show
that are being treated like
a TV show kind of makes characters even better. Like,
but they're not real.
Kevin Spacey. Yes.
They're incredible, but it needs to be acknowledged that they are not real.
But what did
the president in 24, the black president?
I can't remember his name, but I know what you're talking about.
Yeah,
he was good.
Yeah, he was a president. And I was like, that should be a president.
And you know, when Obama was first became president, they asked him, they were trying to get him to comment on it because he was the first black president in the show and Obama was the first black president. So they ask him and he's like, I have no comment. So because he was also the Allstate guy, one of the guys throughout is like, do you think Obama's in good hands with all states? And he's like, that was good. Okay, I'll give you a comment.
Like, just for me on this topic, man.
Palmer.
Palmer, that's it. Idolize, none of them are worshipped. Fictional characters, like the Emperor in Star Wars. I mean, I think I idolize him because this guy has a master plan and he took the time to make it happen, and it happened. I fucking Mario with Mario Brothers, I idolize this guy.
But
right?
you recognize that they're all fantasy, right?
Armin,
you totally recognize their fantasy.
But no one's denying that. We know it's fiction.
I know,
but we're the things that we're idolizing is not the fictional character. It's the personality of that character. Things that we would like to see ourselves be, or we see ourselves as.
Well, okay. Okay. Hugh Jackman, right? I like the way he does Wolverine.
Yeah, you bring that up a lot, like Wolverine.
If you were to meet him, Hugh Jackman, would you feel like you're meeting Wolverine?
No. And I'll say, let me just say what I want to say about Hugh Jackman. What I idolize about Hugh Jackman. It's not his acting. It's not the fact he plays Wolverine.
Those arms, right?
Despite I love Wolverine, and despite I think he plays him really well, for me, it's the fact I like what he's done physically to his own body because he's natural. He started late in life. And you see his progression like 18 years when you watch the first X-Men and look at him, what he's like either in Logan or even the other Wolverine movie. There is a massive change, but watch the movies in order and you see the change from movie to movie. And I'm like, man, if this son of a bitch can get a 1,000 pound club, whatever, this is basically where you do three lifts and they all equal to 1,000 pounds. It equals to that. If you can do that at age 44, I think Whitney did it.
Fucking amazing.
Time for me to do it.
And the reason you find this guy super badass, it can't get more real.
It can't get more real.
Now, yeah, my question is,
that's the only aspect I like about
him. When you meet Hugh Jackman, are you expecting to meet Wolverine?
No, we make the difference.
No, you do.
He's Australian, first of all.
There's nothing wrong to idolize the Emperor and Star
Totally
Wars,
fine.
To idolize Mario. Idolize Atreyu and my, the ending story.
My whole thing came...
Because for what he is.
Don't get me wrong. I have plenty
the ultimate
like
warrior.
All yeah. kinds of fictional okay, characters no that one, I love.
The ultimate
you
warrior.
You know what I mean? But what I'm saying
yeah,
is...
So
what
wrestlers, yeah.
The wrestlers, ultimate warrior. Same thing, okay? The whole thing stems from when I was at Comic-Con once.
Yeah.
I saw a dude... There was a Q&A with William Shatner, okay? And
oh, was that?
Okay, yeah, you were there. And then this guy got up and he started talking to him. And he was almost going to refer to him as Captain Kirk. And he was saying, like, you changed my life growing up. You know, that people used to bully me, whatever it was. It was a really inspiring thing. But at the end of the day, I looked. And the only thing I was thinking is that, but it's not him, dude. The person that you're, who changed, it's that person doesn't exist, unfortunately.
Yeah, but what difference does it make?
Yeah, exactly.
What's the big problem with that?
There's not a big problem with it. There's definitely a line between the
dude,
two.
Dude, when I met the Red Ranger, the original Red Ranger, oh, I was like, fuck yes, yeah. I met him. I know he's
well,
not a
no,
real
wait.
Guy.
My thing is, now that dude, he choked up and he got the tears when he was talking to William Shatner.
No shit.
Okay?
There's extremes.
Wait,
I acknowledge
hold on a
that.
Second.
Yeah.
And it was very much like he was talking to Captain Kirk, though. You know, and to me, I just felt a little bit like, well, that kind of sucks. You know what I mean? Because, you know, William Shatner is not Captain Kirk. He was the guy who played him on TV once. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? But I don't think he took it home with him ever. You know what I mean?
Well, so, I under- never know what there's definitely extremes.
I know,
where people,
a lot. That's
well,
for sure.
I, there's definitely what? Extremes where people take it to yeah. a different level. But I don't think in general,
yeah.
having or even looking up to a certain character that's fictional is... I don't really think it matters, man. Like when I said, like when I met the OG Red Ranger, I knew he wasn't the Red Ranger, but he was the best Red Ranger. And I got to meet him and he was really fucking cool.
It's cool.
But I also think it depends on the actor. Some actors might agree with you and other actors might be insulted by you. Because there's some actors and like
yeah, I mean,
Shane.
If you really take the
remember,
character.
Remember Shane from The Shield?
Yeah.
Okay. Remember when he was suicidal? Okay. He apparently, for him, like some people, like Michael Chiklis, to get into a role,
yeah, they
it's
have
like
to really
right off the bat,
yeah.
it's like, all right, action, and right away they just get into the role. Whereas Shane,
he's got to get it.
He had to get into it off camera and everything. So he had to feel depressed. He had to feel that emotion. He had to actually.
So he's a method actor.
He said, yeah, he's kind of like Heath Ledger.
Yeah, a lot of actors do that. They have to get into character.
But Heath Ledger took it to the extreme. He was living it. All hours of the
yeah,
game.
Jared Leto did the same thing. It didn't do very well.
There's no
yeah.
doubt. All these people played fictional people. I just
yeah,
find
I,
it a
I
little
they,
strange.
I think what they say.
Can, yeah.
I think what I'm trying to say is some actors will actually agree with some of these people that idolize their characters that they portrayed because they felt that at some point in their life they were that character.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people idolize.
I understand what you mean. I understand because it's a personality thing. It's like there's a look, there's an aura to it, but there's a personality thing that's why you gravitate to certain like Uncharted. You love that character. I'm not saying you idolize him, but there's a certain reason why you love him. Why? I don't know.
There's a lot of things that I love.
But I
see a line at the end of the day. As much as I love.
But you don't want to be an adventurer. You want to be in a famous band playing heavy metal like James Hetfield.
Okay, and if I wanted to be a fucking adventurer, I still don't think Drake would be the person I'm really into. I would be into other adventures, and I'd probably say like fucking who's that one that they named the GPS is after? Magellan, what the fuck is his name?
Magellan?
Yeah, him. You know, like, I would do some kind of fucking research on people like this, and I would actually find real fucking people.
You idolize in that final.
I wouldn't go and put that movie with Nicolas Cage where he's going to find fucking treasures and be like
you,
that.
You idolize Spinal Tap.
I think Vince
said Spinal Tap's like a real band.
I think that's what it is, man. We idolize
17 platinum albums. You know, before the movie.
We idolize what we like to be, like exactly what Vince said. Like, I'm idolizing Batman, let's say, because I like for what he is, but I'm not going to idolize Val Kilmer, the best Batman ever, you know what I'm saying? But I'm still going to idolize the character, Batman, you know?
The best Batman ever.
There's the line.
There is definitely a...
That's the line you just fucking agreed with.
Everyone has a line.
And I know you know it. And I know you know it.
I have fictional characters tattooed on me from books when I was a kid.
Yes, because they represent something to you.
Right. Just like
you know it's fictional.
Wait, hold on. You're not idolizing them trying to become like those characters.
No, I'm not.
And idolize doesn't necessarily mean you want to be like somebody.
It means you're inspired.
Like, you know, like really digging some shit.
But inspiration is a big thing too.
I just think somebody needs to know when something doesn't exist.
But there's extremes. It's just like mental people or people who have mental disabilities who they can't tell they blur that line, and that's not everybody. We know that the fucking thing isn't fictional. There are some people who will cry and it's like, whoa, okay, dude, I agree with you on that. It's like, why are you crying? It's not like he physically saved your life and you almost died. It was a character on a show, and yes, it may have changed your life, because I can see the same thing. If there was no David Duchovny for Hank Moody and he didn't play it so well that I used fucking lines from that show in my early 20s, and it fucking worked. Definitely changed
my life.
I've
used lines from everything I've watched in my life, and I've drawn inspiration
from
everything. I've pulled from everything.
And don't you dare tell me.
I'm very conscious about fictional.
Sure.
And real.
But I know for a fact that Will Ferrell and John C. Reilly have changed you a bit, because you pull the same jokes.
Everything's changed me. Eddie Murphy started changing me. Those guys changed me.
Yeah, do you idolize
anything
them?
I watch changes me. But music I listen to changes me.
The question is, do you idolize them?
No, I mean, and there's so few things. Idolize is such a big fucking word. I just mean, like, some people that'll tell you, you know, like, don't talk shit about Han Solo, dude.
Fair enough. That's an extreme, though.
That's my man. I'm like, dude, your man is something somebody wrote taking a shit
fair
one
enough.
Day and it
but
made
you,
a lot
if
of
someone
money
talks
after
shit
that.
About Metallica, you will defend, but you won't be like, shut up, all right, I'm going to hit you. You're not that type of person either. And we're not those type
I'm
of
not,
things either.
But if
you're going to
forget
talk
Metallica,
shit,
you know what? Yeah. Because music also has a bit of fantasy involved. And I might be guilty about some of this shit a little bit when it comes to music. I love the characters in Kiss, the fire-breathing demon, Star Child, all of that. But it's a hell of a topic conversation, though, isn't it? Look at the course.
It's a great topic, man.
Good job.
It's very good. I just think you're blurring the line between extremism and just people who enjoy stuff. Because we're not at all extremists on this shit. If you talk shit about Californication, I'll be like, wow, dude, you're missing out. And
but why would I talk shit about it?
It doesn't matter. It's just an example.
At the end of the day, I think what Iron started to say is, like, you cannot go crazy for fictional characters. Go crazy for someone that actually exists.
No, I think, even if they're real, that's too, like, okay. Like, because replace Captain
Kirk. I just
think
it's more valid in my head, and it's just a fucking opinion. It's like an asshole. We all got one. My asshole says that. No, my opinion is that.
What?
If Batman really existed, I would understand why people would go nuts for him. But you're not gonna go nuts for Val Kilmer because oh my god,
to me,
Batman
someone
for all these people
who worships Sidney Crosby.
Yeah.
Right. And I'm like, yeah, okay, it somehow makes more sense to me than somebody who worships, I don't know, fucking something. Name me a fictional character somewhere.
Vic Mackey.
I would like him more. But yeah. Like, we're taking it as seriously as Crosby, you know?
But here's my thing. Here's my thing.
I just find there's more validation in one than the other.
I don't
all.
See a validation.
But I may be wrong.
Either.
Somebody may find no validation on my side.
Yeah, no, but I'm with you on a bunch of these things, because even like I mentioned Hugh Jackman, but at the same time I also like Chuck Schuldiner. I would search for interviews and stuff. I want to know how his mind is and everything.
If you were to replace Captain Kirk with fucking Prince, and I fucking love Prince, if someone's crying, they're saying you saved my life, you changed my life, I would feel the same way as if
you mean
official.
Prince running the Enterprise?
No.
No,
just Prince.
Machine head.
Like,
oh,
you're
okay.
Meeting
I thought
Prince.
You meant, like, you know,
like, he's a real guy. Because
I don't know if he can
right?
fly that
he wrote,
shit.
No, he's a real guy. He wrote music. You're there to meet Prince.
Boom.
And someone's like standing up and crying. I would feel the same way. Like, whoa, calm the fuck down, regardless if it's fictional or fact, per me, because I really do like it.
I wish I was a Cylon.
I've met some of my music heroes, right?
Yeah.
And when I met them, it was really, really fucking cool, because I was like, you know, I say thanks for the music, whatever, shake a hand. Well, okay, got it. Now, I've also met some people who've played some pretty big roles on TV that I've loved. And my feeling inside, after I met that person, I'm like, well, you know, it wasn't Snake Bliskin. That was Kurt Russell. You know what I mean?
I would say Kurt Russell's cooler.
Yeah, but. No. Nobody's cooler than Snake fucking Bliskin.
Okay, so I went on tour with some of my friends,
that feeling.
Right?
I felt that most.
You know
I
why?
Met Patrick Stewart and Shatner at the same time.
You met people.
No, I fucking paid for that one. I think that was robbery. But
no,
like,
we didn't pay for that Q&A. Was free.
No, not the Q&A. I paid for the stupid picture that we took. It cost me a lot of money.
Yes.
But we did that.
So,
did it for the lady. Right. So, but wait. When I met them both over there, I was like,
you didn't
that's just a couple of old dudes, man.
Yeah,
that's
sure.
not, you know,
but
King John.
To give you a
that's
real
not
example,
General Mortars.
To give you a real example of real people like musicians, Crash Diet were huge. I idolized them for years before I actually got to meet them. Right? I wanted to be them. I loved everything. And you know why they say never meet your heroes? Because they're nothing at all with what you have in your head about them. You're thinking they're the coolest people fucking ever.
I met Rob Flynn.
And I
spoke with him for 15 minutes.
And I toured with Crash Diet for 5 weeks.
I know.
And they are cool guys. But when you get to see them not being the fucking grand band that they are, they're not. It's not the same. And they're real.
It goes to what I said at the beginning. And Armin, when you idolize,
the only thing
that
I love that band is the music.
Yeah, and the music
and
isn't
the
real.
And the person that I respect for that music is the creator of it.
Yeah.
So my hats off goes to those four guys in that band.
But I understand your point. That's more legit than me. Venom because.
But
of
some people
does.
Don't
totally
have this. Some people are totally like, and I can use the word idolizing for some of these people, but fictional characters, and I just feel like I feel bad for them.
Some of them
sometimes.
Might
like,
be
that's
obsessed.
Like, I said, I can almost
obsession.
Like there is something at the end of my line. Yours is as bleak
but
as religion, dude.
Okay, but
you know, like it doesn't exist, and you're choosing to.
But you keep straddling the line between obsession for a fictional character,
maybe,
and
yeah,
just
I've
liking.
Because the thing is, I've seen the obsession part. It's pretty
right,
crazy.
But I think an obsession for either a fictional or a factual character.
Is
an obsession, and it's a stupid. When you get to a point where you're living your life by this one character, real or not, I think it's crazy.
Yeah.
I don't think that's like
you don't live
man,
your life by. I just mean drawing. You know, like when you say we all have our heroes,
getting emotional about a fictional
getting
character.
Heroes. Right?
Yeah.
They say we all have our heroes, right? I think it makes more sense when your hero actually exists. That's all.
I think a lot
and
of the
Superman and Batman is how many kids' heroes and Spider-Man.
Oh, he was mine.
You know, everybody's
Superman
heroes growing
mine.
Up. You know what I mean? I don't mean
when
they can't be heroes, but to
I,
me, you know.
I think it's a little
but
bit more.
But how cool is the Punisher?
He's very cool.
But that's what I'm saying. At the end of the day, what's cool about fictional characters is all they are, it's all we see.
Yeah.
Real people. You like one thing, but then you go outside of that thing and you realize maybe they're asshole, you know?
The chances
attitude,
are they're all assholes.
You know the Attitude Era of wrestling? All those wrestlers, they all said it's their character that they put it from one and they put it on 10.
But
so
I'd like to say this, especially in regards to today's shit. I think a lot of the fictional characters on TV shows, even through all of time, are more real or more valid than the shit the fake people stuff are posting online, that they stage it. To make it look real.
Yeah, draw.
And I
want to
be like that guy. And he's a real guy, but it's all faked.
Well,
I think that's more real to idolize a fictional character than the guys that you see on Snapchat and shit.
My thing I said, it comes down to it when, like I said, some of these guys meet the actor and they think they're meeting Wolverine, dude, but they're not.
It's because you see that
but
face.
But now, like, we should go on, we should agree to disagree.
I think I think we're all in agreement. We're just on different pages of the book.
My uncle is right.
What page are you on?
71.
No, it's actually 23.
Yeah,
dude.
Page 23, man.
Actually, you know what? You know about 23? Another thing? Patrick Watt was 33.
Yeah.
But there's a secret 23 in there. First of all, the last number is already there. The last digit, right? It's 3.
Yeah.
Now, if you take he's one being. So 3 minus 1 is 2. So there you go. 23.
23, man.
23.
I work with a bunch of idiots.
It eludes you, dude. We all see it.
I didn't know your voice could go that high.
You'll understand one day.
Anyway, so I guess we're jumping on to the next topic. Segway here. Segway. I'd like to pose a question to everybody. Do you believe?
Yes.
In the actually a Star Trek line. The needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few.
The need of the many outweigh the need of the few.
Resistance is futile.
So meaning that sacrifice depends. Of a 2%, so it's greater than, it's more important than the survival of everyone type of thing?
Yeah, so you have a million people, right?
Yeah.
And there's a drug and they're all diseased.
Yeah.
The drug will kill 30 of them, but save the rest of the million.
Oh, that's worth it.
It's okay. Fine, dude.
Yeah, I think that's worth it.
Now,
we're not going to be part of those 30, right?
That's what I was going to next. So imagine you're part of the 30.
Okay.
Or you're the one who has to administer the drug to your child or whatever. Now, do the needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few?
Well, I mean, if to test the drugs, we need to test it on.
Forget
people.
About testing. Just I would that
taste
we know
them in prisoner. We're talking a few weeks
forget,
ago.
Forget about
it's
testing.
It's too vast it's, of a question.
It's a logic question.
Yeah, the thing is, add all your stipulations.
There's a lot of things involved, Justin.
The
what if
stipulation is
different it, scenarios you know the calls for there. Different levels of being
that's
selfish.
I know. I agree. Yeah,
so how do we know?
So I'm going to give
selfish,
you
how selfish you are is going to decide that
right.
question.
And here's the thing. Wait. Hold on.
I didn't ask the question.
So electric cars have this problem. They can't figure out how to program them. Not electric cars, excuse me. Self-driving cars have this issue, this logical moral issue, and they don't know how to program it because it can only go one way. If your car is about to hit something, is about to crash
into
it.
Who does it sacrifice?
And you can't, the car will automatically try to save you. But if you're on a highway, there's a, think of it like Final Destination, the fucking logs come off and there's no way your car is stopping in time, you're gonna get hit. You can either go this way or this way, but there's people there. What should the car do? Should it hit somebody, potentially kill them, or should it just sacrifice you and save the two other people in the car?
Well, if it tries to hit someone, that car, if it's programmed,
no,
you
also
mean will try
people,
to avert danger.
That's
too.
Only if there's all automated cars.
Yeah, that's what
now,
I mean.
If it's that just a new car and this happens, what does the car do?
Well, what would you do if you were driving?
Well, wait.
Ask yourself that.
Question, wait.
You would right away.
Here's a better way to answer
pull
this.
Out of the way of that thing.
So
right?
Should the car do that?
100%.
Here's a better way to answer this because I don't know the answer. Maybe one of you guys knows it.
There is no answer.
Wait. What did they do when we went from horses to cars?
But people were still
but
in
people
control.
Still controlled both.
Yeah. You didn't
in
have
this
the programming.
Case, you're taking control out of our
hands.
Yeah,
but you're going to tell me a horse was not in danger?
No. Okay, the horse was in danger, but it was still like you can
but
get
did
on.
They
but what I'm saying is, did they outlaw horses? That's what I'm wondering.
It's not about...
To
it's
make
this,
way
wait,
for
you're,
cars.
You're jumping
so that's
in.
What I'm saying. Will they outlaw manually driven cars for a...
They may. They may outlaw.
Cars.
They may outlaw. But I think we're jumping on... What I'm trying to point is... Okay, let me change the scenario a little bit. On the highway.
Yes.
This stipulation, all right?
Yeah.
You're going to get hit. The logs of wood are going to hit you and the car doesn't have enough time to stop, right? You're going to die.
Yeah.
Now the car has to make a decision to either save your life or hit a person on a there's two motorcycles. One wearing a helmet, one without a helmet.
Yeah.
What should the car do?
I mean, what do you think you would do in that situation?
No, well, there's three choices. You hit a wall, you hit the guy motorcycle no helmet, the guy motorcycle with helmet.
With a helmet.
So there's three options.
What should you do?
I think
what should the car do?
I'd like to get an answer from all of you before explaining something. So what would you do, Ivy?
I can see my reaction.
If what I would do for sure, if I was already, I would avoid the wall because it's
that's their human reaction.
No, wait, there's no way. That's the scenario.
I'm just saying if I see a wall in front of me, I'm gonna try
it's
to
not
avoid
a wall,
it.
It's a truck with logs coming on top of it. You're on the highway, you're driving with you're on the highway.
So I turn right and hit people, or I turn right and fall off a cliff.
No, you turn right and you hit a person on a motorcycle with a helmet, or you turn left and you hit a person on a motorcycle without a helmet.
These are my options. I'm gonna hit the one with the helmet.
But
okay.
But I mean,
fine. What would you do?
Well, I don't drive, so I don't know. But I would think that you wouldn't have the reaction to you wouldn't
make
even have
choice,
to make the choice.
Right.
I
but
think
a car still has to be programmed.
Yes, I get it.
Yeah.
I'm saying as a human. Your reaction time, your reaction is going to be whatever you think at that split second is the right thing to do. You're not going to know or think, oh, guy has a helmet. I might as well try to hit him. Your natural reaction to get when you get scared is to go left.
It's not my point. That's not what I'm trying to get to.
There is no. I think there is.
Okay, but if you're
whatever my reaction is,
if you're a computer programmer, what would you do? What would you do? Who would you hit? If you had to decide, it's not about a reaction time.
It would be the one with the helmet.
Okay, now what would you pick?
As a programmer?
Yeah.
Oh, I would put the wall and I'd make...
No, there's no wall.
No, the logs. I mean, I'm stay course. If it means getting out is actually killing somebody else...
Okay.
No.
Okay.
Is that the option where you hit the guy?
No, that's an option. You can choose to kill yourself.
Oh, I'm pretty certain.
Why would you pick the person with the helmet?
No, I'm not choosing to kill myself. I'm thinking like a programmer.
No. Don't. You can't think like a programmer. You have to program for stuff that you can't get out of. That's the issue here. You can't get out of this.
Behind this, I find the best answer to this.
Yeah.
Is not killing somebody else. It's you going.
So you're taking the hit then.
100%.
Okay, that is a valid point. You could take the hit.
So me when I answer,
but it's not only I'm driving.
Forget about you driving. It's a computer.
I don't pull out of the way. 100%. I couldn't tell you which one of them.
But if you were programming it, you would program the car to take the hit.
Oh yeah.
Okay. Why would you pick the person?
Well, because me when I made the choice, it was two choices. I hit the guy with helmet and no helmet. So based on that, I hit the one with the helmet because. Technically, he has more chance of survival.
Okay. Okay. So, I'm assuming it's the same reason.
Yeah.
So, here is the moral dilemma between all three.
Yeah.
If you hit the person without the helmet, you almost condemn them to die.
Yes.
Because they're not wearing a helmet.
Yeah.
However, you guys chose to pick the person with the helmet.
Yeah.
Punishing the person who followed the law. Just because they have a better chance of surviving. And then what happens there is people will just stop wearing helmets because they keep getting hit by these cars. And you probably picked the one that everyone agrees on. It should be the person who's in the car who gets hit. Would you buy that car knowing that it's programmed to sacrifice yourself and you have a daughter?
Only when it means killing somebody.
That's fucking amazing point, though. If cars were programmed to hit people, they don't know what's going to happen anymore. That's amazing.
And would you buy that car? Because they've polled people on this and they all say it's for the greater good. It should sacrifice the person in who owns the car. And then they pulled the same people, would you buy that car? They said, no, I'm not buying that car.
Or you program it so as soon as the instant it senses the danger, it goes to manual.
Right, things change. Manual override. Now, that only works for people today because in 50 years from now, after all these years of automation, they're not going to teach you how to drive. Jono has a point.
Yes,
they may outlaw driving.
50 years from now, hopefully all the cars will be self-driving and... Self.
I think there's still the things solution.
That's the only way.
There's still things that you can't account for. Mm-hmm. In fact, you can have all these self-automating cars, right? But let's just say freak snowstorm and shit, and it's ice everywhere, and the cars can't control, and they're all going out of whack. They can't physically control it. Now, imagine you do gain traction, but all these other cars are going haywire.
But that'll happen to you if you're driving in the
snow
over here.
I'm not trying to make a point for self-driving cars or not. What my point is trying to make is, would you buy that car? Knowing that it would sacrifice you in a dead-end scenario, would you buy that car?
The argument changes in 50 years when everything is automated.
But it's a dead-end scenario regardless of the time.
No, because then... Not just you, there's the other car also that now knows you're going to swerve there, and so does the one next to it, and so does the one
next to it. So same scenario, right? But now it's pedestrians. You're on a collision course for something,
yeah.
And now it's pedestrians, they're not in cars.
All right, okay. But you know
in
what?
In that case, don't drive through fucking pedestrians. Take the bullet, even right now.
Would you buy that car?
Knowing that today you
knowing
would
that you will be more injured or potentially die instead of someone else dying.
Look. I understand where you're getting at. It's just that there's accidents that will always happen.
Right.
Regardless.
But wait a minute.
Reaction time, we're not aware of it. It just happens. And it's an accident. But now someone is choosing it.
This question doesn't really touch enough on the greater good. I just wanted to touch
on the small part of it. Would you buy that car knowing that it would sacrifice yourself? It's for the greater good. More people will be survived. You're only one person that dies. Maybe two if there's 10. If you have someone in the car with you. Would you buy that car? Because I know I fucking wouldn't. And that's why I don't want a self-driving car. I don't want that having to be... Some programmer had to decide that. And that's a terrible moral issue because we just discussed the dead-end scenarios that can and will happen. Not in great amounts, but it will eventually happen. If there's that one small chance that I'm not in control of it, even though humans cause more accidents than anything else, I don't want it. My reaction time... Far be it, may kill somebody, but I couldn't control it. It was literally out of control.
Here's what I think. So they're, you know what will happen? They're going to tell people, or how I think this issue should be handled. I think cars should not sacrifice the person in the car, should try to save the person in his own.
It would always will, yeah.
Okay. Now, what they will do is, because if you think about it, it's going to be impossible to get simultaneously every single car that is not self-driving off the road at once. Imagine there's a transition period. So what they're going to say is, they're going to say from this point on, all cars have to be blah, blah, blah.
There'll be laws, sure.
Okay. And it's going to be now up to your own risk if you're still driving a manual car. A driving car. Okay, you know what I mean. So whether that takes you 5 years, 10 years before you finally get a self-driving car, you're at your own risk. And I think that this will be something that...
I still think the point is...
I get it.
No, because even with all... Even if all cars are self-driving 100%, there will still be issues.
Oh, there will be. But I'm saying, if, like Armin was saying, when all of the cars are going to be self-driving,
it'll be less frequent.
Yeah, will be less frequent.
I know.
So I think some people, that as soon as they'll hear that, oh, well, it's at my own risk now, I might just get a car. Now, I know not everybody's going to jump on it right away, but it's going to push people to convert eventually. And that's what's
going to happen. I know, it's going to happen over a great amount of time.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, if you knew, moral dilemma isn't about like self-driving cars. Moral dilemma, if you knew a car was programmed to kill you, would you do it?
No, like me, it's same here, man. I choose the guy with the helmet, but based on what Vin said afterward,
you would get the car now.
But if car would be programmed, I mean, I'm just drifting a little. If car would be programmed to hit the wall, hopefully there will be some kind of fucking.
It doesn't mean you'll die, but it does mean you win an accident.
That means that you'd sign off on a car that says I'm gonna turn left or right.
Yeah.
Even though if it means killing other people,
it's a terrible. Honestly, man, I don't know how to do that. I don't know how I would be able to program that because it's a decision where someone dies.
I'm asking you if you take that car.
Yes, because I'm saving my life. And if I have kids, if I have someone I love in my car, I will always pick someone I love over a stranger.
So
I don't
care.
So you
would drive the car? You would take it?
If it was that, yeah.
See? Makes you a fucking asshole, man.
It does. Okay, but would you...
But here I am.
Would you save somebody else?
I would turn if I was in the fucking...
There's another moral dilemma thing with a train track. You have the option of changing the route of the train, but both end up killing people. There are four people tied up on the train track.
Yes.
And don't get into the specifics of... I can untie them. No, forget that. You can only be AB, all right? And then there's your wife. Four people or your wife. What are you doing? A or B?
Well, you know, I've been married a long time now. It's enough. No, I'm just kidding.
You'd kill the four people, right? Even though four people survive and one dies versus one survives and four die. We all have that in us where we will protect the people we love even if it kills a billion people.
Yeah, well, it depends. See, four people, I would definitely save Rosemary. But if you're talking about a billion people...
I might have to negotiate with the YA, you know, and stand.
I don't know.
It's a tough situation.
If it's
four
stranger,
I don't know. I would probably change it towards that.
I'd probably pull the plug on the entire world for my daughter. Yeah, okay.
Well, and you know what? I thought, like, when I can't sleep, I think about this question. Given the, like, being in this scenario, if I had to kill half the world's population to save one person that I love, would I do it? Yeah, I would. 100%.
Yeah, no shit. How many people?
Half the world's
like
population.
3 billion people.
Half the world people?
These are fucked up questions, but if you have the
That's
option,
a lot of fucking responsibility on your head, man.
You kill one person that you love or half of the world's population? Guys.
I thought about it long and hard, man.
I would kill the person I love, man, unfortunately, because I know that person would probably kill me.
Obviously, people have a different... When it's that great a number, because...
But
now
what if it's
like
your kid?
What if it's your kid?
I'm not answering that.
Yeah, see, that's what I'm saying. I think, like, for Ava, I would probably...
You would do it.
I know, on the whole
plan,
but
you know
I'd
what?
Be like,
yeah.
Fine,
if you would
take
do it,
it,
I guarantee within 24 hours, you're dead. People would kill you, bro.
Yeah, but it's still... He would take the hit,
he would still
but it would keep his daughter alive. And I'd be willing... I'd
for
be okay
all,
with that.
That's a clock.
I would be okay with that.
Not me, man.
They would
actually probably kill his daughter before they kill him.
Definitely.
No. Let's say... No, okay, wait, hold on. Witness protection of some sort, all right?
You better get in that shit before you do it.
I have a billion, man. Half the world's population, so no one's going to help you.
Who gave me the option?
Vin.
I was the sick fuck that put half the world on the fucking table.
That's true. There's gotta be, okay, so in a drug administered, you only have one. You can save your daughter or have them replicated, but your daughter dies. I would fuck you, I'm giving this to her. The whole world dies, fuck you, all right?
But it's only administrable once?
You have a syringe. Jesus. Half the world has a disease, including your daughter. You were the one who synthesized it, but they need to get this synthesized in time to make enough of them. But if you do that, you give away your drug and your daughter dies. I'm saying, fuck you, I'm giving it to her first.
Right.
You should have created one.
That'll happen. But as a result,
yeah, but you can't answer like that.
He'll go to prison for the rest of his life.
But you can't answer the way you did. Fuck you, you should have, because that's not a question. The question is, at that moment, like anything else, you kill the person you love. I don't like to say daughter because I'm not a father, so I don't have that connection, you know? Like, the only closest connection I have is Luce, and I would definitely kill the dog.
I think this is a numbers issue, because half the world is a lot.
That's a lot of fucking people.
What if it was 10,000 people?
Between, let's say,
10,000 people and who?
And your daughter or your wife, your brother, would you pick?
Man, I'm selfish when it comes to the people I love.
You see, me too.
Yeah, but we say that now, but two.
It would be a tough decision, but I think
you would have to make the decision on paper. Dude, and the world's watching you and everything.
One of them looking at me saying, trust me, do it. I will do it. I'm like, shut your mouth. I'm going to wipe out these 10,000 right now. Take it easy. They're only 10,000.
I would definitely struggle with it, but I would be more comfortable. I would be able to live with myself killing 10,000 people that I don't know versus one person that I do. At the right concert, it
could be a blessing.
Well, what about you, John?
That's another thing. It depends.
I have no opinion.
Really? Nothing? Not even
more? It's a touchy question.
Too hard for me to answer.
I think, because the needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few only really is logical and makes sense when they're not talking about it in your context.
Exactly.
Well, when you're talking about the greater good as like away from it, a bird's eye view perspective, yeah. 100%. But as a person who has to be in that situation, almost no one ever picks that.
But you say this now, man. I'm telling you, if you would have the situation to save one or half of the world, I'm telling you, whoever it is, that person will die.
There's going to be a lot of persuasion from the other side. Hey, come on, man. No, there's fucking 4 billion of us.
It's not even that, man. You know? It's not even that. I mean, at the end of the day, if you had that option, like seriously, half of the world or one person.
You're going to make a lot of friends.
It's like the pig fucker from Black Mirror.
The pig fucker.
Either your daughter dies or you fuck a pig.
I just saw that.
Well, just for that, I would fuck the pig. Like, I mean, just that.
Yeah, you would fuck a pig too, right?
For sure, man.
Would you fuck a pig?
Hey, John, would you fuck a pig to save my life?
Yes.
Yeah, I'll pop a little Viagra.
Yeah, he's a given. You might not need it.
Nothing Jaeger can do.
You might not need it.
Would you? So that was my thing. Just a moral issue of... We say a lot of these things that make a lot of sense, except for when it's in your context. Yeah. Sorry?
I liked finishing it on pig fucking.
I know. I was just like that. End it off here. I just wanted people to think about the things that we all agree on collectively may not make sense when it's just one of us and we have to deal with it.
But
that
it's
close to
numbers game.
I think you might be right. Yeah.
Imagine somebody said to you, Ivy, I'm going to wipe out the Bastards Council or 3/4 of the planet. What do you do?
Fucking kill us, man.
I got a feeling 3/4 of this planet is going.
We don't know what's going on right now outside this room.
Come on, it's not one against them. It's the four of us, man.
Yeah, well, because it doesn't even have to be people you don't know. Because imagine if we were tied up on a track. And then Annie's on a track. You're picking. We're dying. And I'd be like, you know what? I'll see you when you're dead.
That really sucks, but yeah.
It's a numbers game.
You know what? Dude, if I'm on there, I'm like, well, at least this is going to be a quick death.
It'd be like, all right, I'm dying with you guys.
I'll
tell you what. If I let you guys die and save her, and the three of your ghosts come back to haunt me, I assure you it'll be 10 times more digestible than if I let my wife die and then her ghost comes to haunt me.
She's
gonna fucking terrorize me, man.
How many lives do you think you're worth?
Really? You want me to answer this?
I'm just asking you the question. Like,
how many people on this planet right now, today, right now?
7.5 billion.
Multiply that by 7. Fast!
50,000.
Subtract 4?
20. We're not going to 23!
It all comes back to 23.
No final confession! This guy ruins it! And we only got a couple words to say to you!
Armin works here!
See ya!
Motherfucker!
throat is fucked.
Stop sucking that dick.